Stone Roses from Noel Gallagher and the man who is about to step into bassist Pete Garner's shoes, Gary Manny Mounfield. In 1987, Manny joined to make up the famous foursome, about whom Ian Brown once said, "It's either us four or no four." A bold statement which wouldn't be forgotten by fans in the traumas of the following years. Manny remembers how it all fell into place.
I'd been in a band with John in probably about 1982 or something. We did some demos and I left because I think I just started doing a couple of crappy jobs because it wasn't paying, you know what I mean? And then hooked back up with him, and I was actually working at in the theatres in Manchester, in the Palace and the Opera House. And I never used to walk from the Opera House to the Palace in my dinner time, but I had to go and see somebody. And as I was walking up Oxford Road in Manchester, I bumped into Ian and John, and then he got to put the advert up for bass player wanted. So it was like, it was weird kismet, man. It was meant to happen. I suppose everybody did bring their own little something. Ian was always too cool for Christmas, you know. He was an handsome boy, used to break a lot of girls' hearts. You know, he was never scratching around for the date. John was always the cool, arty one. Good brain at working in Squire's Head. Rennie's just super dynamic. I was somewhere in the middle, like lukewarm water, man. No, that was just fun and up for it, the spirit, man.
A new sound was born in Manchester, rooted in the past and boldly stepping out to seize the future. Sally Cinnamon was released in May 1987 on the Wolverhampton-based Revolver label, a distinctly poppy introduction to the Stone Roses.
Sent to me from heaven, Sally Cinnamon, you're my world. You are my world.
I mean, from the start, you could tell they had something just because he was such a great drummer. And Ian Brown definitely looked really good as a frontman. And they looked like a gang, you know, they had that thing and they had such a confidence about them. Even in the early days, it was like, you know, people always go, yeah, Stone Roses, they're the next band to get out of Manchester. They're going to be massive.
Sent to her from heaven, Sally Cinnamon.
Two bands, the Stone Roses, the very first LP was influenced by, was a band from America called 3 O'Clock and Primal Scream. Nobody else has really picked up on that. I actually lived in Manchester in 1988-1989, and that's when I first met Manny. And I know that that was what they were into. They were massively into the 3 O'Clock, they were massively into Primal Scream.
Alan Mcgee, the president of Creation Records, with some insight into the Roses' early influences. Things were hotting up for the Stone Roses and Manchester in general. The Roses were picked up by new label Silvertone Records in 1988. The contracts had a lot of holes and black spots, but there still weren't many takers for the Stone Roses in those early days. The Roses' Elephant Stone was the label's very first release. Exploded in a shower of ecstasy, funk and psychedelia. By 1989, God, it seemed, had finally got around to creating Madchester. Or the enemy had, at least. Noel Gallagher speaking as a roadie for the Inspiral Carpets.
I always wanted to work for the Stone Roses, but I ended up with Inspiral Carpets for some bizarre reason. I remember at a gig once at the university where Clint Boone told us to take off my Stone Roses t-shirt when I was still on the side of the stage. It's fucking very sad. And told him it was bad karma on his behalf. I think all the bands literally fucking hated each other. I think the Mondays and the Roses used to get on vaguely. The Mondays were just out there. They were just like a big gang of desperados, really. I don't think anybody really got to know them that well. I mean, you know, I speak to Sean, I spoke to Bez, but that's about as near as it got. You wouldn't like going out of their house for fear like you'd never get out, really. But certainly all the rest of the bands didn't really get on.
But Manchester was the only place to be by 1989. Alan Mcgee was just one of those who decamped.
I just broke up with my missus, so I was like, could go anywhere I wanted to go kind of thing. And I went to Manchester for 6 months and creation became all sort of dancey. It was quite interesting. Used to get in people's flats, and, you know, and they'd be fridge fills of ecstasy. It was like quite an interesting place to be at that time. But it was also like chemically fueled as well.
Even Ian Brown went on record.
It's really good, it's really exciting, there's a lot happening, and Manchester was sort of rejuvenated by the acid house scene. Last summer it had been quiet for 10 years, but now it's happening.
Saw the release of the truly seminal Made of Stone, and the standard for British guitar music was set. John Robb still sees the record as a crucial part of Manchester's culture.
Made of Stone is such a great song, that. They write words where there's no direct interpretation of music like them sort of bands do. But that stuff about the burned out car and the twisted faces and all that kind of thing, that it reminds you just walk around like a human, like all the South Manchester bohemian kind of areas, you know, where everything's like a bit smashed up and broken and everyone's a bit like messed up in their heads. The whole sound, the song, it makes you think of like misty rain that always around Manchester all the time, you know.
Sometimes I fantasize when the streets are cold and lonely.
What's it about?
Sometimes I fantasize when the streets are cold and lonely.
But what's that about then?
Self-explanatory, isn't it?
There probably is no better way of explaining the essence of Ian Brown's poetry. You either get it or you don't. But the Roses were already getting themselves a reputation for being difficult and tongue-tied.
In a month, we'll just be whipping boys and they'll just be dismissing us. But at the moment, you know, flavour of the month.
And part of that has been signing an 8-album deal. How do you feel about signing an 8-album deal? That's quite daunting, isn't it?
We'll do 7 live ones next year and get out of it. We'll just take it as it comes.
We knew people G'd up, you know, for us to come back, so we wanted to bring them down, disappoint them, ruin it for them, you know, spoil it, wreck it.
But Gareth Davies, whose company Beer Davies worked promoting the band on radio and television, insists they were misunderstood.
In essence, I just think they were very shy. The first interview they did was Music Box. It went out on ITV, I think. Then they came down to do Newsbeat, actually, was the second one they did. And I met up with Ian and John in the pub, and I was amazed that they had these notes of things to talk about. And I said, why have you done that? Was it a long journey or something? And they sort of said, no, we thought you were really upset after the last interview, so we thought we'd try and make an effort to have things we can talk about. And so I thought, well, this is very good. But again, when the interviewer Newsbeat said, have you got anything you want to raise? And they had the notes in front of them and just said, oh, no, don't think so. The same when they did Johnny Walker on GLR. And I spoke to Ian before and said, just try and be quick with the answers, you know, so you don't get this dead air. And the problem was that Johnny Walker sort of said, so, this is going to be your first time playing in London. And Ian quickly said yes and followed it by nodding furiously. So Johnny hesitated, thinking there was going to be more coming. But Ian had fulfilled his part of the deal by just answering quickly.
Wanna Be Adored, the story of the Stone Roses on Radio 1. Manager Gareth Evans was one of the more colourful characters in the business and was also fast gaining a reputation for himself.
I heard a funny story once. He was driving along in Chester somewhere with Bernard out of New Order, and they're passing this house, and the manager said, "Oh, that's a nice house," and Gareth sort of spun the car into the driveway and got out, you know, knocks on the door and said to the people who come to the dog room, "And who are you then?" He went, "Ah, my name's Gareth Evans and this is Bernard Sumner from New Order," proceeded to try and like sell this house to Bernard, and these people didn't even want to sell it, so the story goes. And Gareth's like trying to be in the middleman. These people are going, "Can you get out of the house? You know what I mean? Who the fuck are you?"
The person I worship was Gareth, because they had a manager who was loonier than they were. I always think all great bands have great managers, it's a rule, and Gareth was no exception. Gareth was a loose cannon of megaton proportions and a fantastically entertaining human being. So, yeah, I really enjoy Gareth.
Tony Wilson. Spring 89 saw the release of the debut album that had been recorded in London the year before with producer John Leckie. Leckie had been seduced by the Elephant Stone demo and a classic Roses show at the International 2, and he was enthusiastic about twiddling the knobs on the Roses' first long player.
We made it in parts, actually. We did four songs at first, which I think was Wanna Be Adored, She Bangs the Drum, Made of Stone, and one other I can't remember. We did four songs at the beginning. Everyone liked it, and so we said, let's go in and do another four. We kind of did things, almost finished them, and then everyone believed we could do it better, so we went in and did it better. And we finished up doing Resurrection at Rockfield Studio. The song was written, and they always just used to jam the end, and we would say, oh, let's do a fade at the end. And, you know, we spent a good few days rehearsing, arranging that end so it sounded like something special. There was a great feeling of positivity about it. Well, we were going to make the greatest record ever, which is what I always say when I go in with bands. There's no point in recording something unless you really believe it's going to be the greatest thing ever. And here I was with a band, and all of them really believed that.
According to Leckie, it wasn't exactly sex, drugs and rock and roll in the Battery Studios.
When all the publicity came out with the Roses, it was like, here's these drunken hooligans, you know, every kind of bad thing, every kind of vice that can be thrown at them. You know, they're sex mad, drug mad, drink mad, everything, they're just crazy. But they weren't. But they kind of rode all that and said, well, if that's what people want to think, you know. I mean, they didn't drink. I'd probably drink more beers than them, you know. Ian doesn't drink beer. They have occasional glass of wine with a meal. There's no big boozing. There's no bottles of Jack Daniels or anything like that.
The Stone Roses' debut album turned thousands of heads in 1989. For Noel Gallagher, it laid down an essential challenge.
The Stone Roses kicked the door open for guitar music in the late 80s anyway. We're like credited with the renaissance of British guitar music in the 90s, which is fair enough because we have done a lot for that form of music. But without that band, who sort of they opened the door a little bit, you know, for us, and then we just came and just opened on and nailed it to the wall.
Me in your splendor, all the plans that I have made.
the first LPs, I mean, they all hate it, ironically. I mean, Manny says every one of them hates that record. They're embarrassed by it, supposedly. But I've got to say, it's one of my top three or four records ever. I love them.
And true enough, with typical Roses perversity, the band themselves were unsure.
Really what we wanted to do was to get the songs recorded with the same power and dynamics as they had live, but John Leckie sort of, he took a lot of that away, but also added something else. You know, I think he made them a bit too sweet. I think we'd have probably wanted the Stone Roses LP to sound a bit more like The Second Coming, you know, just with the power and all that. But it ended up sounding like Herman's Hermits or something.
Though Manny does concede the huge effect of the album.
People still stop me in the street now and go, thanks for changing my life. And it's like, I've made a record, man, you know what I mean? It's weird to comprehend sometimes, but it does to people. Sometimes when you're that close and you're in the eye of the storm, it's hard to understand what it does to people, your music like that.
October 89 saw the Roses take London's Alexandra Palace by storm and took the Roses and Happy Mondays to Top of the Pops together, where the Roses were to perform their most lauded and challenging record yet, Fool's Gold. Unsurprisingly, the recording did not go off without a hitch. Gareth Davies again.
The band, when they came down to London, always used to stay at the YMCA at the time. And I went to see them there, and they were sort of telling me that they didn't want to do Top of the Pops. And eventually, they sort of said, yeah, okay, well, as long as we can have, like, amps on the stage. So I arrived very early. The producer at the time came storming down. I remember his words to me were, what other problem we have with this band, the Stone Roses? Liza Minnelli and Barry Manilow never gave this much trouble. And I thought, oh, my God. I had a word with the floor manager, very understanding guy, who was a Stone Roses fan. Eventually, we did manage to get a couple of amps on the stage. And then the band arrived in their car, and as they got out, I'd said to John and Ian in particular, the first out, just treat this with an open mind, shall we, and just going back, and they sort of said, yeah, okay, go, but the cars are staying, you know. It was only at, midday on the day of recording that they said yes. Those cars were waiting outside, and I had the privilege to tell them they can go now.
'90 kicked off in true Roses style with the most famous paint job since the Sistine Chapel. Manny.
This company, FM Revolver, Paul Birch and what have you, he kept re-releasing that Sally Cinnamon song, right? And that's all right, I suppose. But then he goes and makes this video to go with it, right? Which was very tacky. He didn't have any of us in it for the start. He had someone reading a copy of The Face with Ian's head on the front, loads of pigeons, you know, and Manchester stuff. And it was like, hold on a minute, you know, you're getting a bit out of order here. And we phoned him up, and his excuse was something like, I've got a Mercedes to run or something, you know, as if to say, mate, to justify it. So we're heading down to Rockfield to do some sessions for the first LP, and we said to Steve Adger, our tour manager, just stop here at this DIY centre. He must have thought, this is a bit strange, we all come back with these 5 litre tins of paint. And then we said, right, we need you to just stop in Wolverhampton and for a few minutes while we go there. We went and knocked the door. I think his girlfriend came at the door and said, right, we want to see Paul Birch and all that. And she starts, yeah, I mean, no, you can't do this, and the other. And then he starts coming down the hall, we just steamed in. But unfortunately, she got a lick of paint as well, but just had the paint all over him, and it was like four chimps on acid, just running around his entire offices, smashing stuff up, pouring paint over everything, putting windows through on his cars. We nearly ended up going to jail for it.
Summertime brought the most celebrated Stone Roses show in their history. Spike Island was halfway between Manchester and Liverpool, an oasis of greenery flanked on all sides by ugly industrial estates. It was a great coming together of Roses fans, a cultural high point of the late 80s. Simon Berkovich was 16 at the time. Like many, it was his first rock gig, and he remembers the show through a fan's eye.
We arrived probably mid-afternoon, and the place was already completely packed. Something to walk through, and just seeing a lot of people sort of dressed in very similar styles, regulation hats and flares. Everyone thought that it'd be a very big day out. We knew they were on sometime during the day, probably early evening, but we sort of didn't quite know what was going on that day. And in the end, it just turned out to be a lot of DJs. For about an hour before the concert, you could tell that things were winding down and a lot of people were moving forward. They picked the optimum time to appear on stage. The sun was going down, and there were the rumours flying round. They'd arrived by helicopter, they'd done this, they were already there, they were mingling through the crowd, lots of rumours going round. And then everyone started surging forward and just waiting for the band to start. Then intro tape, and then eventually this amazing roar of the crowd as they walked on. And then it was dark by this point, the lights had gone on, and the first thing that sort of you could hear was just this enormous roar of John Squire's guitar. It's the first time I'd heard anything that amplified. It was just this enormous engine taking off. It was brilliant. Apparently you could hear it for absolutely miles. There was definitely a lot of shell-shocked people wandering around. I don't really want to speculate why that might be, but a lot of people were quite stunned, I think. A lot of people were very impressed. And it was just a feeling of, well, when's the next one? My friends divided into two camps. A lot of people thought it was terrible. They didn't like it. They didn't like the crowds. They didn't like the fact that they couldn't hear it properly. But then there was me and my other friends who just thought the whole anticipation sort of leading up to that just one gig was amazing. It was the best thing we could have done.
Unsurprisingly, the bloody-minded Roses were unhappy with the show.
What that day was for me was started at about 9:30 in the morning, got knocked up out of bed off my brother and his mates, all wanting the tickets. And me, I was left pacing around in my own flat till 8 in the evening when we got picked up. I thought it was all right, you know, could have been better. Some technical crap was going on. I think the wind was blowing in the wrong direction and the sound was going over there when the audience was over there or something, man, like that. Oh, and other times, you know, for instance, when you're on stage at Glasgow Green and you're right on one, and something happened there when we were in that tent. We all just looked at each other at the same time and just went up another total level. We knew we'd cottoned onto something. It was great.
Allegedly the Roses' favourite show and often cited as their greatest live performance, the Glasgow Green gig took place in June 1990 in a huge tent in Glasgow's East End. Peter Keenan and Fraser McGowan were among the city's rabid Roses fans.
When we actually went to get the tickets, I can remember it being absolutely crowded at about 6 in the morning. Because we were there at 6, and I think we actually got about the last 100 or 200 tickets. Yeah. At the time, it was very important to us to get that ticket. As in, I think if it had a came, it would have jumped the queue. We would have basically did anything at the time.
We had to get our hands
in some way.
We left the house about 2 o'clock, went and got a wee carryout, and then I think about 5 past 2, we realised, no, go for a big carryout. Just had a look across Glasgow Green and saw this massive queue. I thought to myself, well, there's no way I'm standing in that, so
we jumped the queue.
We cut halfway, aye. Played innocent, or?
No, I don't think we played anything, that's a lie, we just jumped the queue.
These guys come on the scene, 4 guys.
Well, basically,
totally different.
They just look like total gods, let's face it. To us, anybody who had their hair any longer than a short round back at the side of your ears looked brilliant.
I actually went maiden in my dad's collared at the time, just for a couple of tops.
Your old boy was looking pretty smooth at that time, actually, wasn't he?
Still stuck in the 70s, mate.
The gig in general for me was pretty important for the point that it kept my interest in rock and roll. Probably if I hadn't went there, if I hadn't heard the Stone Roses, I might have lost faith in rock and roll.
Your soul.
forced to be the last British Roses show for 5 years, till I saw the release of the Fool's Gold follow-up, One Love, and a sadly aborted attempt at rock and roll terrorism on the Wogan Show. Gareth Davies.
I remember going to see the band up in Glasgow, and the first thing John, when he saw me catch was, said, is it true we're doing Wogan? They were really pleased to do this, because the idea was to do it straight and come off, and then that's it. So everything was hunky-dory, and then I got a call, what I'm saying, that they wanted to be interviewed on the programme, and I thought this was very bizarre. I suppose then I put the phone down and started to wonder why would they want to be interviewed, and knowing the way that they were so savvy in using the press, and I could never ask them this, and I could never say it to anyone, but I was seriously concerned, because I really did think they maybe wanted to reach over and pull off the, whether it's there or not, who knows, the so-called Wogan's wig. Because I thought one night, and I thought, God, that would make so much sense, because if they did that, they'd never have to do TV again.
It would have made quite a swan song, but it didn't happen. For the next few years, neither did the Stone Roses. They allegedly went off to Pembrokeshire to rehearse for the next album at the beginning of 1991, but there were no reports of any work being done. At the same time, their relationship with Silvertone, whom they had already suggested they were unhappy with, had seized up, and they went to court to free themselves from what was reportedly a particularly one-sided contract.
When we signed the contract with them, really, I don't really think we paid it enough attention, and our old manager, Mr. Evans, he got the solicitor who would get to go for the contract was a mortgage solicitor who apparently had been struck off. There was something very bizarre in it, which meant us not getting paid anything, and we still haven't been paid anything. I wasn't paying, man. I was busting my ass for 10 years of my life. I wanted my mum to have a new car, but it was horrible to have the brakes put on just when things were really starting to happen, you know. We was injuncted from writing, recording and gigging for a band. What are you going to do?
But it wasn't just the legal wrangle that was affecting the Roses camp. They were growing up and apart.
I think that's where it maybe started to go wrong a bit, when we stopped socialising with each other. I don't want to be crude, but you know what everyone's feet and balls smell like after being on a tour bus with them for 3 months, you know what I mean? You want to get a bit of space when you got time off. And we did stop socialising, and then everyone started having kids and all that. So that sort of, like, cuts down your social angle.
John Robb.
Well, to me, I think in many ways, Stone Roses are like the Clash of their generation. They're the band that could be absolutely massive and just pissed it all away, you know. Legal wrangles, drugs, rock and roll lifestyle. They also had a penchant for taking it quite easy, you know. I mean, they became more withdrawn because as they got bigger, they moved out of town into their own houses. And they got a girlfriend, you got kids, and once you got kids, you've got that sort of little gang going around. And then it's, so like, it's not like all your mates sit around your flat listening to love albums anymore. The real world starts creeping in, doesn't it?
I left a couple of times. There's some crap internal politics going on. I didn't want to be a part of it anymore. But a week later, they come begging you to come back, don't they? It was becoming like a bit of a two-tier system in operation there, you know, where it's one reel for one and another for another. You know, I couldn't live like that, so I said, I'm leaving. I walked out of the rehearsal room one day, and he was around my house a few days later. I didn't really want to come back, but I did. Yeah, I wasn't happy. When I write the book, you'll hear a story that you will not be able to believe.
Roses eventually won their case against Silvertone and were immediately signed by American giants Geffen with an alleged $2 million advance. But the case had taken its toll, not least on the band's relationship with manager Gareth Evans. In early 92, he was sacked. And what did the Roses do with the rest of the year?
I think it was a bit premature to go in the studio, because instead of having everything written and just going and throw it down, we were writing as we were going, and we had a lot of problems and some real heavy personal stuff. A couple of members of the band had a bad time of it for a couple of years. I think it was maybe only 50%, 60% of...
They didn't really want to live up to it. So I guess at the back of their minds, you know, they were thinking, we've got to do better than that. The whole success of the first album made the second album really difficult to do. We kind of exhausted ourselves, really. I mean, we sort of worked so much and knew each other so well. The spark had kind of gone, really. It's like a kind of love affair, really. You know, it just gets a bit stale sometimes. And so I said, well, if nothing's going to change, then I'm going.
Noel Gallagher learned his lesson watching from the wings.
It's just a pity it took 2 years and they lost momentum, and probably, I know from experience that once, if you have 6 months off, it's really hard to get back into the swing of things. Once your mind's switched off from songwriting and being in a band, You don't just pick up a piece of paper and say, and like today after, you know, 6 months I'll write a song. It just doesn't work like that. I mean, it's the biggest mistake you'll ever make in a band if you're listening to kids. It's like, don't have no time off, you know, just keep going.
It was November 1994, 5 years after the debut album and a few important months after the arrival of another Manchester guitar band called Oasis on the scene, that the new Roses single Love Spreads was first heard on Radio 1's Evening Session. It went into the charts at number two. Itself, the audaciously titled Second Coming, was greeted by the music press with disappointment. It was described as anally indulgent, a paean to Led Zeppelin, a step backwards. Though they were possibly a bit hacked off by the band's exclusive album interview with The Big Issue, the music press implied the dream was over. With hindsight, the album now seems to many to have been chronically underrated.
When your heart is black and broken, and you need go unanswered, and the silence is killing you. Take my hand, baby, I'm your man. I got love enough for two. Tell a story, love song. I built this thing for you.
March 1995, the first real death blow struck the band when Rennie, long considered the greatest rock drummer of his generation, left the band. The real reason for his departure has never been made clear. He was always quite a mysterious figure.
I've never met Rennie, but from what you hear about from people who know him, he's a bit mental anyway. So it's like, a lot of people didn't really think that he'd left anyway until Robbie joined, and it was like, oh, so he has left. So, like, he's proper left. Everyone's like, yeah, he's proper left. I just thought he'd gone off his head for a bit. A lot of people in Manchester actually thought when they first seen the Stone Roses that he was the star of the band, because he used to sing as well, and I've seen him do some outrageous things on a drum kit. I mean, it'd be like Keith Moon leaving The Who or something like that. It's the same as like Aziz trying to replace John Squire. I mean, it's like, you don't do things like that.
He just didn't want to do it anymore. Got so depressed and pissed off with it. Trying to relight his spark after having it snuffed out for a few years, it's very difficult for everybody. And maybe I think Rennie saw a vision of how it was going, you know, before anybody else. Very intelligent lad. I was pretty gutted, actually, but I thought I could see the reasons why I didn't want to do it.
Robbie Maddox replaced Rennie and the band gave a typically reticent but oddly prophetic interview to Radio 1's Joe Wiley.
Sounds good. It's playing again. Rehearsing this week. Ready to go again. So if we don't split up or lose our battle.
The last time that you were here, if you don't mind us talking about it, Rennie was here. Have you seen him, had any contact with him lately?
He's been in Spain.
Doing what, on holiday?
Yeah.
Did he need to take a holiday to take a break?
Dunno. Just ask him next time you see him.
Have you not had any contact with him?
No.
Still, there were some brilliant gigs left in the Roses, as their late 95 tour proved. Just when it looked like it might be safe to start believing in them again, disaster struck. John Squire left the band. The Roses' bitter response to his leaving, first demonstrated at their 1996 Reading Festival press conference, shocked many of their fans.
He hasn't wanted to play with me since 1991. He hasn't wanted to play with Rennie since 1991. He hasn't wanted to play with Rennie since 91. He hasn't wanted to play with any of us. Where do you think we've been all this time? I've been knocking on his bedroom door asking him to come out to be with us.
Because he felt his power threatened, because we was all getting a bit too good for him.
We was too strong for him and we was too nice to him. That's what's happened. But because the kid's so meek and quiet, I was there for him. Let him do this thing, let him get this out of his system. That's what he wants to do. I'm with him, because we've got all the time in the world.
One from five is four. Wouldn't even bother to phone me house if he heard my mum, dad, everybody who was in my lineage was killed in a motorway crash. Because he can't be asked to get out of his bedroom.
He became friends with a bag of cocaine. He put that before his friends. It's a filthy business, but it hasn't touched us yet. It's a filthy business, it hasn't touched us yet.
And a follow-up Radio 1 interview, including replacement guitarist Aziz, did little to quell the fans' beating heart.
I'm not interested in running out, giving flyers out, saying it still exists. We just get on with it, let people speculate all the time.
Guitarists are ten a penny, man. It's not about replacing them, it's about going on with a new style, man, and a new thing. John was good at his time and he'd done the LP that he wanted last time. It's Led Zepp fantasy. But we're above all that, man. Never really liked him anyway.
I suppose it is kind of strange in the sense of taking on somebody else's parts. So once I play them, they become my own. It was like I was meant for this band in the first place and some joker was there before me. What can I say? Ready to blow, got the hunger to go.
Manny.
I never want to expose any weakness to the press, because that's what they're looking for. And they were all there looking for it that day anyway, you know, and they'd all sat there like they'd come and see a funeral and we'd give them what they wanted. Great. John was left with no option but to take off, because certain members of the band weren't pulling it out live. I hate blushing on stage in front of people, but I'd always play my part. I think there was lapses of concentration going on. I was a bit angry with John when he left the group at first, but then I think it was poisoned a little bit. I was maybe being a bit selfish and thinking about myself and the rest of us, but the more I think about it, he was left with no option. He had to leave. I stayed with Ian because I didn't want to be deserting him and leaving him in it too. Maybe it was the wrong thing to do. Well, in fact, I know it was the wrong thing to do. I should have left there and then, but my stupid loyalty kept me with him. He's a friend, you know, so I had to stick by him.
To I Wanna Be Adored, the story of the Stone Roses on Radio 1.
This is the daybreak, and this is the love we make. But love is the law here, you got to know how I love it, yeah. It's more than a mover, you know it takes all fast or song. So cold wild, bring the love in some brother man, true nature child. Georgia, to Lockside Manchester, everyone ready, so Rob Baker's a way, Sister Rosalie Parks. Love forever, her name in your heart, forever in my heart. Woo, hey.
Despite the band's public united front, Manny had already told them he was leaving after the Reading show. The Roses maintain to this day that their performance at Reading was not unusually bad, but Ian's broken voice and the low quality of the new songs had the press proclaiming the death of the Stone Roses the next day. Melody Maker journalist Jennifer Nine was one of the reviewers who came to that conclusion.
When they finally came out, and just the first few guitar chords and just the way they sounded, I thought, I felt like my heart was in my mouth. And I don't know how many seconds that is, like 10 seconds till the vocals come in. And for 10 seconds, it was like the best gig experience in my life. And then Ian Brown's, when he opened his mouth, it was like a bad joke. I've never seen anything like that on a stage before, anything. He was bellowing like he could not hear and he couldn't think and couldn't remember the lyrics. There'd be people with hands up to their mouths, and there were people crying. There were definitely people crying. I was crying by the end of it. And he kept looking out into the audience and, oh, you're pretty quiet out there. Someone just said, it's the shock, mate. He couldn't sing. He wasn't there. He didn't know.
But Reading, it just looked like he's detached from the whole thing, you know, it's really odd. He's been going through the motions, and when the drums started going, come on everyone, clap your hands, and all that, and the dancing girl, it was like, Jesus Christ. It's not even Stone Roses anymore, it's a Robbie Maddox 5, isn't it? He stood there thinking, that's it, this is the end.
And for John Robb, the show made clear that the mantle had been passed on.
Their last ever gig at Reading or something, I was watching that, there's these kids sitting next to me going, look at him up there, like Ian Brown, he thinks he's Liam Gallagher. I was thinking, Jesus, that's really weird if he'd gone like kind of full circle, haven't it, you know?
Did you ever feel the pain in the morning rain? I soaked you to the bone. Maybe I just wanna fly, wanna live but don't wanna die. Maybe I just wanna breathe, maybe I just don't believe.
A few weeks later, the Stone Roses officially split up, and Manny announced that he was joining Primal Scream. The Primals continue to be one of the pioneers in the current British rock scene, as influenced by the Roses, as the Roses were once influenced by them. In fact, the influence of the Roses is all over this week's charts, from the Verve to the Charlatans to Oasis.
I remember when the first time that I wandered in to see Oasis, and Liam was like incredibly charismatic. He had like total presence, the kind of presence that Ian Brown sort of had, although it wasn't like Ian Brown, but it was the same sort of haunting kind of presence. Up in the Sky, off the first LP that they played that night, is for me is like a total Stone Roses homage, really. And me being me, I never went away thinking Oasis was going to be the biggest group in the country and probably the world one day. I just thought I might be able to sell 500,000 albums and be as big as the Stone Roses.
They were our band, I suppose, because we got on it before anybody else in England, and then they made us feel special. And of course, at that time, there was all the Manchester-London thing. If thou from Manchester, thou shalt inherit the earth, you know, Tony Wilson used to say in my bed. They sung in Manchester accents, they wore the same clothes, they went to the same clubs, you know, you could see them down, you know, the same shots where you were buying, you know, the same Army and Navy shots where you were buying your desert boots and your flare jeans. But all that aside, really, in the cold light of day means nothing now. What you're left with is like the music. Pure and simply boils down to the day that, you know, wrote some of the greatest songs of the late 80s.
Noel Gallagher isn't shy about his debt to the Squire Brown writing partnership.
If you play Cloudburst, which in the way that Radio 1 compiles these documentaries about now. And then if you play Standing Here by the Stone Roses, which will be fading in right about now. Find that they're both exactly the same tune.
I see the wheel keeps turning. Manny went along to the Mercury Music Prize this year to represent Primal Scream after their Vanishing Point album was nominated for the award. John Squire found himself another writing partner and is currently in the charts with the Seahorses' fourth big hit, You Can Talk To Me.
Don't you think that maybe I should slow down? I've got so many things to say, I had to write them down. I was feeling alone, so I'm on the phone to you. Now that you're here, I hope that you're hearing all the words I say to you. I've talked myself round, so talk to me too. You can talk to me anytime that you feel that way. I'll take a strain. You can talk to you, then talk to me.
Story goes is recording with a new band in which he sings and plays guitar, and Ian Brown's long-awaited solo album is out in February, a month after the release of his first solo single, My Star.
Space exploration, Olympia stations, NASA corrupted, you have got it. Space exploration, extension to the stars, on a military mission, on a military journey to Mars. I see you in my star. 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 I see you in my star.
I think I put every fucking penny I've ever earned out of this group on the Stone Roses not reforming ever. But imagine seeing them all doing a Manchester Revisited tour in about 2010 or something, you know, like Jerry and the Pacemakers and Freddie and the Dreamers done, you know. Saying that though, I'd be fucking down the front.
It does seem unlikely that the famous Roses foursome will ever grace the same stage again. But we can live in hope. Manny can't be the only one with regrets.
If I could have changed anything, I'd have stopped everyone leaving and carried on, because I think we could have made some excellent music together still, because there's always a spark there, which I think it'll be pretty hard to recreate with another group.
Your face, it has no place, no room for you in.
Adored was presented by Mary Anne Hobbs and produced by Jane Graham.
Stone Roses story as it's never been told before. That was I Wanna Be Adored.